Today's webinar is proudly sponsored by the Dairy Farmers of Wisconsin. With over 1,200 licensed cheesemakers and the only state that requires licensing to be a cheesemaker, they're also the only place outside of Europe that has a master's cheese program. Welcome to Cheese In Depth. I'm Michael Landis, and today I have Matt Erdley with me, and he's a master cheesemaker, a Wisconsin master cheesemaker with Klondike Cheese Company. And we're gonna talk a little bit about the history of Klondike along with some of their really unique directions, especially in sustainability. And then of course, we're gonna taste some cheese. So I'm gonna turn it over to Matt and he's gonna introduce himself plus Klondike Cheese Company. Matt.
All right, thanks, Michael. Hi, everyone. I appreciate this opportunity to talk to everyone about this facility that I get a chance to work at called Klondike Cheese. So little bit about me. I am part of the fourth generation of Klondike Cheese, started by the Buchholzer family, and they're still here. I'm a part of that family. So I've been with Klondike Cheese for about 20 years, learning under Ron, Dave, and Steve. Some of their cheese craftsmanship trade. I am a licensed cheesemaker, and I also hold a master cheesemaker status for Brick and Munster cheeses. So that's a little bit about me. But let's start talking about Klondike Cheese and a little bit about the history of us. So Klondike Cheese is located in southern Wisconsin, kind of central southern Wisconsin, close to the Illinois border. And Klondike Cheese Factory has been around since the 1800s. Used to be called the Staffecker Factory, I think, years ago. And around 1925, there were many co-ops in this area, Greene County, Lafayette County, where we reside, that had milk, and they wanted to do something with that milk and add value to it. So there's also a large population at that time of immigrant cheesemakers from various countries in Europe. And so around 1925, this local group of farmers formed a co-op and hired a cheesemaker by the name of Ernest Buchholzer. So he started making Swiss for them around that time period. Well, as years went on, he had a family, and his son, Alvin Buchholzer, after he came back in World War II, took over cheesemaking responsibilities from his dad. And so he made cheese here in the facility starting around 1946. And you can see a picture there on the screen of Alvin and Rosa and Ron Buchholzer when he was a small child. So things have changed certainly in the years of cheesemaking from that picture till now. So around in the early 70s, 1972, Alvin and Rosa and their three boys, Ron, Dave, and Steve, decided to purchase the assets of the cheese factory from the co-op and form their own business. And that's where the modern version of Klondike Cheese started. Kind of a side note about the history of Klondike is, how did it get its name? And it said that at the time, the original cheese factory burned to the ground and they were building a new one. And we have a lot of limestone in this area and it's extremely tough to work to blast away all that limestone. And some of the workers commented that, well, we might as well be up in the Klondike up in Alaska digging for gold. And so that name just kind of hung around over the years. And obviously that's the name of the company today. So moving on from that, over the years, Klondike Cheese has made a variety of cheeses, including Swiss, Wheel Swiss, Cheddar, Monterey Jack, Colby's. In the 80s, I'd say the late 70s actually, they added a few more cheeses, Brick and Munster cheeses. And then around 1984, Ron, Dave, and Steve pictured there, had some interest from some customers they'd done business with about making this cheese called feta. And so they worked the craft, they learned quite a bit in the 80s and in the 90s and had built up quite a feta operation. And so we continue to make feta cheese today, albeit with maybe a little more modern techniques than what they were using in 1984. So moving on from that, around 2004, as a companion cheese to the Brick and Munster we make, we added Havarti to the mix, and we've been making that here for, 16, 17 years now. So continuing on the history of additions and growth as the company has been doing, in 2013, we really looked into doing and built a plant to make Greek yogurt. You know, that was something that it was, at the time was fairly popular, was growing and it was all over the place. And we got into it, built a whole new facility strictly to make Greek or custom blended high protein yogurt. And we are still making that today. So where we are right now, of course, Ron, Dave, and Steve Buchholzers, they've been here their entire lives, making cheeses and yogurts. And now the fourth generation, which includes Adam Buchholzer, and Luke Buchholzer, and Tina Buchholzer, and Melissa Buchholzer, and then myself. At times I feel like I'm the only one here not named Buchholzer. We're making what we feel are high quality, consistent cheeses to this day, including the yogurt products. So I guess moving on to, you know, one of the things that we talk about here and mentioned at the beginning, master cheesemakers. And this is a great program that the Dairy Farmers of Wisconsin sponsor, and the Center for Dairy Research administer. You know, it's to, I guess, raise to the top cheesemakers in the state of Wisconsin and to show and highlight their excellence in cheesemaking. And Klondike Cheese is so fortunate that on staff right now, we have 6 master cheesemakers, and they're all pictured there, from Adam and myself, Dave, Ron, Steve, and then Ron Bechtold. We're all certified in all of the cheeses we make here. And we all had to go through a similar process to get certified for the cheeses. So many of you may know what the master's program is about or have some ideas, but really I like to think of it as a minimum of a 14-year process to get that master's certification. You know, when you start out like I did, you have to be an apprentice for a year learning the basics about cheesemaking, and you apprentice to a cheesemaker, and then you can apply for your cheesemaking license, which I did. But to even qualify for the master's program, you have to be making cheese for a minimum of 10 years. And that gives you time not only to continue to learn and develop and about not only cheese making techniques, but sanitation and quality processes and consistent product. You know, you're learning and crafting and honing your skills as a cheesemaker to get to the point where I feel good. I feel like I can grow. I feel like I understand, at least on some level, the art of cheesemaking. So after 10 years, a minimum of 10 years, you can apply to the program. The program itself is quite rigorous. It's about a 3-year program. You need to be making the cheese or cheeses you want to be certified in for a minimum of 5 years, I understand. And you submit an application, and then there's an oral examination where representatives come to your facility and they test your knowledge on basic cheese making, quality systems, sanitation, to make sure that you do understand the basics on how to make a safe, consistent product. But then over the course of that 3 years, you're going to attend classes where you can expand your knowledge, where you think you understand cheese making, you know how to do it, but now they're going to tell you why it works and why this process helps and what this does during the cheese making process. So it really expands your knowledge, understanding more of why. In addition to those classes, you'll be submitting cheese samples for evaluation at the Center for Dairy Research. They want to evaluate your product, your cheeses, to make sure that they exhibit the characteristics of that product and they're of the highest quality. You know, that's really what the whole program's about. I mean, they're going to look at microbial levels and other such things, but the whole point is to have a consistent, high-quality product that can represent the state of Wisconsin as a whole. So while you're taking your classes and after your oral examination, you're submitting samples for them to evaluate. Then at the end of everything, there is a written examination, and it takes, I would say, at least 40 hours. It's rather intense. You're doing a lot of research. You're justifying your answers and justifying where you found them, to really show that not only have you gained some new knowledge, but you're also taking that knowledge and applying it to the products you're making so that you can take them to whatever next level of quality or standard you're targeting. So it's really important. It's a really important example of the culmination of the program saying, listen, I'm willing to do the work because this, I understand how important this is for not only my products, but to represent, you know, Wisconsin in the cheese industry. So you submit your application, your final exam, and then they go before a board and evaluate you. And if you meet the criteria, then they will apply the title of Master Cheesemaker. So quite involved. I attained my Master Cheesemaker status in 2018. And if an opportunity arises again, we'll take a look and maybe we want to get certified in more cheeses. Right now, just two cheeses for myself, Brick and Munster. But there's all sorts of opportunities in the future. So yeah, I guess from there, you know, maybe talk a little bit about the plant. And I think there was a slide that popped up a second ago about, you know, what makes good cheese, right? And this hits the nail on the head for us and for, it should be every cheesemaker. This area, Green, Lafayette County, wonderful, wonderful farmers who take a lot of pride in making consistent high quality milk. If it starts with the milk, and if the milk is good, you got a place to go and make a fantastic cheese, whether it's at Klondike or any of the other cheese factories around this area. So again, these farmers and our patron farmers, we have around 60 patron farmers that supply us milk, take a lot of pride. And it's really a partnership where they're providing a high quality ingredient to make the cheese, and we're taking it and turning it into something I think that's pretty good, pretty awesome. And so that partnership is, we've had some of these farms for decades. So we're really proud of that relationship with them and the hard work they do to every day, 7 days a week, generate some fantastic milk for us to use. As far as the facility, we do have three plants on site. But one of the things we talk about here at Klondike is, you know, we like to call it a circle of sustainability. You know, what do we do, and are we being responsible with this fantastic resource that's here, this great milk that our farmers are providing to us? And we like to think we're good stewards of that resource. So of course, you know, the farmers do a great job of providing milk, and we bring that milk in, and then we store it in silos, and then we pasteurize it, you know, when it's at the particular plant that it's going to make the product, whether it's yogurt or cheese. Then we'll make good, high quality, consistent cheese, and we'll package it. And then, you know, we have this thing that's called whey, right? When you make cheese, you make cheese and you have whey. And I don't think it's a secret that years ago, whey was considered a bit of a byproduct. You know, what do you do with whey? How do you get rid of it? You know, animal feed or whatnot, or dispose of it. But now, not only is there value in that whey, and that's something that we take advantage of, but it's also, again, utilizing this really good resource that the dairy farmers provide to us. So we'll take the whey, we'll make the cheese, and we'll separate out the whey and hold that whey, but we'll also extract other components out of it. We will extract cream. We will extract whey proteins, and those whey proteins and the cream will be sold to companies that can go into other food ingredients. And then we'll also extract lactose out of this whey, and we'll concentrate it, and we'll sell it to a company that turns it into animal feed. Well, then now we have this water, right? We've extracted components and we have this water. What do we do with it? Well, we actually clean that water up. We filter it and clean it up, and we will use it in the plant as part of a sanitation process, a cleaning process. So again, we're trying to use this good resource to its fullest as much as we can. You know, for any water that's left over that we can't use, we have our own wastewater treatment plant on site. We don't haul the water away and dispose of it in a field. We try and treat the water. We clean it up with anaerobic and aerobic lagoons, bacterially treat it to clean it up. And then we have around 400 acres around the factory here that we use spray irrigation to grow fields of alfalfa, okay, which is then harvested and fed to these wonderful dairy cows, to kind of complete the circle of sustainability for us, where, again, this is a valuable resource, it's a wonderful resource, and let's use it to its fullest. And so we've embraced that, and we've been doing it this way for years and years. So I guess moving on from there, you know, Klondike Cheese, we've got a few brands under our umbrella. Obviously the Odyssey brand, Feta cheese is a large part of our business, but the Odyssey brand also encompasses Greek yogurt or high protein custom blended yogurts. And then under the Buchholzer Brothers brand, we have semi-soft cheeses, which would be Brick, Munster, Gouda, and Havarti cheeses. So we do have three plants on site, and each one specializes in its own product. Again, it's kind of outlined there. Included in the Greek yogurt, which I did mention before, you know, it's not just yogurt, but it's also sour creams and dips and sauces. You know, we'll get a little bit more into the product breakdown a little bit later, but, you know, the sour cream and the Greek yogurt we manufacture is used in a lot of different applications for food service or ingredients. And so it's a wonderful product to start a lot of those dishes with. So a couple explanations about the feta plant. You know, years ago, the way that they used to make feta in the 80s and the 90s, was really difficult. Open vats, which is fine. They're very commonly used around. You would make the cheese, you would add your lipase and your rennet, and you would firm up your curd, and you know, and then you would cut your curd. But feta curd is a little different than your cheddars or your Colbys, where it's a very soft curd and it breaks very easily. So it has to be handled gently. So the actual act of physically scooping out the curd out of the open vat and pouring it into forms in another finishing table was excruciating. It was very difficult, very time consuming, very hard labor. So around 2000, we invested in state of the art feta cheese making equipment, which has been upgraded several times in the past 20 years, not only to make the process less labor intensive for us, this state-of-the-art automation has also allowed us to make a more consistent product. It allows you to control your fats and your moistures so that the product that we sell to our customers is the same every time they get that package. And so very proud of this. You know, it's not, there's some companies that do this, but I think in the end, this type of automation has really helped us handle the curd, keep it consistent, form a wonderful product, and take some of the physicalness out of it, as well as allow us to expand our business and grow. The next facility, I think, is it the yogurt plant or is it Munster Bay? Is this the yogurt plant? So this was built in 2013. Again, all the products we make here are pasteurized. We don't make any raw milk cheeses or raw milk yogurts or anything. You know, in the yogurt plant, it is fairly automated, state of the art as of 2013. And we'll bring raw milk into this plant, and we'll what we do is we skim the milk. We pull the fat out because, remember, I talked about we're a custom blend plant, and we will make what the customer desires. So we'll take that fat and we'll take other ingredients and combine it back into the skim milk to create the right fat content or protein level that our customer wants. So once that's all blended, mixed together, For Greek yogurt, you need to pasteurize at extremely high temperatures to help denature proteins so that they want to hold on to moisture and give that consistent body that you're looking for in the yogurt. So we'll pasteurize it. They'll go on to ferment tanks where they will build their acid and build that solid mass of yogurt. And once we've reached the right pH point, we'll break it. That means basically cut that curd, break it, and we will pump it to our filling points. Our final destination, the package, which could be as shown, the 5.3 ounce retail cups that we all eat from every day, up to over 2,000 pound totes of yogurt that could be used more for an ingredient customer. And then the last facility I think we talk about is the, we'll call it semi-soft cheeses, which would include for us the Brick, the Munster, Havarti, and the Gouda cheeses. And again, this is, you know, years ago, not too long ago, up till about 2018, we were making cheeses in traditional double O vats. You know, we would make the curd and cut it. And then depending on whether we're making Havarti or the Munster, you may do some pre-draws to draw off whey, or you may do some washed curd where you add water to rinse lactose off the curd, depending on what you're doing and stirring. And once the curd's prepped, we would pump it onto tables where there were individuals taking and raking curd and filling up individual forms for Munster and Brick. And again, very labor intensive. And then each one of those forms, you know, if you think of that was 4,000 pounds of cheese, you know, and each loaf weighs 6 pounds, you know, you can imagine each one of those forms had to be turned upside down 3 times during its time on the table, about an hour and a half, which again gets to be very physically intense. And then all the forms would have to be removed and all the cheese would have to be removed by hand and transported to a brine system and put into the brine by hand. Again, very labor intensive. So in 2018, we decided to expand and modernize our Munster make process, where again, we make cheese in vats, typical way, similar to the way that we always have, but then now we have curd handling equipment where we can put the curd into forms and the forms can be handled by machines and machines can turn it, which again, number one, took a lot of the physical labor out of it. Two, allowed us to expand our plant, but three, again, allows consistency of the product. We make it the same way. And every time you open that package, it tastes the same, it feels the same, and it works the same. So that's very important to us. You know, Klondike Cheese believes quality, quality, quality. That's what we focus on. That's number one for us. You're gonna get the same consistent high quality cheese every time we make it, or yogurt every time we make it. And this equipment in part has helped us to achieve that. So, you know, we do have a food safety system. We are BRC certified, which is a global food safety standard. We've done that for years and we've got an A rating every year. So, you know, the BRC is say what you do and do it, and continue to meet these standards for high quality. So we do that. So yeah, that's kind of a summary of what the plant does. And some of the cheeses and things that we make. I think there's a little bit more information here to talk about what we do specifically. So to talk a little bit about semi-soft cheeses, again, I've mentioned them several times between the Brick and the Gouda, and Smoked Gouda, Havarti, and Munster cheeses, all, you know, loaves and small retail sizes. We do a variety of things with them. We can cut them into small packs, but primarily we sell loaves to people for conversion that they may want to use in their process. Yep, and that shows you an example. We do slice packs and we can do 8-ounce cuts. Again, all of the milk that we use is RBST free. And this shows you kind of a variety of what we have to offer. Just shows you some examples of what you can use this product for, which I know Michael will get into in terms of pairing and how to, you know, get the most out of these cheeses. But between the Munster and the Gouda and the Dill Havarti, you know, they all melt well. They're great melting cheeses. And depending on what flavor profile you're looking for, it can definitely add a little zip or a slightly different flavor to just kind of a standard burger or some other application. But all of those as well are great table cheeses too. That's something that that you see frequently around here. So we do not only retail, but we do food service and industrial accounts to cover kind of our customer bases, I think. So just to kind of highlight some of the awards, you know, we've been making a lot of these cheeses for a long time and you know, we've been fairly successful with all three shown up there between the Havarti, Munster, and the Brick. So we've been fortunate enough. I think a lot of the awards have been World Cheese Contest, ACS, US Cheese, Wisconsin. You know, again, we work hard to try and have high quality cheeses and we've been fortunate enough to be, like I said, have some success in some of these competitions for these three cheeses. So we do a variety of products. Again, it's the same RBST-free milk that we source from our local farms. And again, you know, kosher, but we've again, the contest, you know, the judges have spoken. We've been, again, fairly fortunate over the years with a good quality product. We've been able to place fairly well at all these different contests. And so we're pretty proud of that. You know, there's a lot of versions, retail versions of this between, you know, 8-ounce cut of feta cheese. But, you know, you can get crumbles, of course. The other thing too is that about feta cheese, which we're not going to talk about too much about today, but, you know, if you know about feta cheese, a traditional feta cheese is stored in a brine for most of its life. You know, you take it out of the brine, take the component that you want to use, and then put it back in the brine and just let it get better with age. We do offer a retail version that's an 8-ounce in brine that's available for purchase as well. So it's kind of like a mini barrel or a mini bucket, if you will. And then this is more of a food service where we do pails, which is, you know, again, simulating that barrel experience in various sizes. Crumble bags and of course, feta loaves are available through food service distributors. So Greek yogurt and cultured products here. So what a wonderful, I guess, variety of options we have here. We do the retail and you can see the flavors. My personal favorite is the peach, but a lot of people like the pomegranate, the 5.3 ounce, just, you know, good solid traditional Greek yogurt items. You know, our products we think we're pretty proud of them because we try and push and get the sugar, you know, lower than other comparable products. We've worked really hard on the fruit preps to attain that, but still provide that fruit flavor that everyone's looking for. And then in terms of other products that we have available, I like to think that, you know, you go up in sizes, you know, 24 ounce, there's some blended yogurts, you know, the prior ones are fruit on the bottom, stir them up and enjoy. These are more of a blended fruit flavor. And as far as from 2013 on, you know, we've been fortunate enough again to win several awards through all these wonderful contests. And we'll continue to strive to win those awards as a measure of ourselves against everyone else to show that we are still doing a good high quality product and that everybody likes. We do dips. Everything is a Greek yogurt base or high protein base. So we do a really nice tzatziki dip, which I think we'll be talking about today. And show you what to do with that. But it is a Greek yogurt base. It's got some really nice fresh cucumbers and garlic and dill flavor in it. So yeah, we'll be expanding on that later, I'm sure. And then there's also some other dips that we offer in a variety of flavors from bell pepper to French onion. Again, everything is a Greek yogurt base. So it's got all that creaminess and that good flavor to it with probably a little bit lower fat. We do some 4 ounce for food service for colleges and schools. At the bottom, again, it's, you know, left to right. It's Adam Buchholzer and Luke Buchholzer and Dave Buchholzer, Ron Buchholzer, Steve Buchholzer, and Ron Bechtolt and myself. You know, this is kind of the collection of people that are working really hard to try and make high quality products every day here at Klondike Cheese. And so, you know, we'll continue to strive to do that, the fourth generation and beyond, and see where things take us.
That was excellent. Thank you. I really appreciated that information on the sustainability and, of course, the farmers that you work with. It's always important to know, you know, that those are some of the key points about where we are today and what we can do to help sustain our resources and also help out our farmers who do the tremendous amount of work every day. So that's really cool. So, do you have anything else you want to add before we wrap it up here?
No, other than, I appreciate it. This was great for us. Give me a chance to kind of talk about our family here and our business and the chance to meet you and see what people can do with the products we make and how to enjoy them a little bit better. So appreciate the opportunity to talk to everyone and this has been a great experience for me.
Good. Well, Matt, it was a pleasure meeting you and spending the time here. Love your products and, you know, really enjoy the quality and thank you so much for sending them out. And we're going to definitely be enjoying them this evening. So thank you.
You're welcome. Welcome.
All right. Well, this program will be on my YouTube channel. And of course, you can get the cheeses for yourself and taste along with us if you want to. It'll be listed out probably in the next couple of days. So again, thank you, Matt, for stepping in, and I really appreciate it, and I'm sure we'll talk soon.
All right, take care.
All right, you too. Bye-bye.
Bye.